So we can talk about the robotics, which is mostly a software company originally, but we happen to be on top of designing robots, sort of robots, but also designing the hardware. And that's what I'm going to present today. So the main thing is that we've been designing open hardware for years with various tools, and we had serious challenges to integrate that to our workflow as software developers. And so I'm going to present you how we used to design hardware, how we do design hardware today, and a few projects where we actually applied that workflow. Okay, I'm going to try to talk a bit louder. So how we used to design hardware up until recently is that we were used to a set of tools that we learned either at school or in previous jobs. And so, namely, mostly Agile Designer for our PCB design and SolidWorks for all our 3D and mechanical design. And both of these projects are really good in the sense that they have a ton of features which are very useful. It's okay, I bought it. And so yeah, we used Agile Designer for a very long time, which is like a very, very powerful piece of software. But we had like a few drawbacks with our challenges. One of them is that Agile is supposed Windows only, and we have only Linux machines, so we needed either to reboot our machine every time we wanted to reboot our board to design our firmware, or to actually have like always two boxes on our desks. Another like tricky part is that Agile has this license-based system, which very often makes you a bit stingy when you start wanting to work on a project and you realize that your coworker is already using it and you can actually not design hardware anymore. Another thing is that we do design a lot of like stack of boards, and so very often we want to be able to visualize several boards in the stack at the same time to actually like ensure that your connectors are actually matching on both sides, to avoid surprises later on. And so having the ability of running several instances of the same software on the same machine is very convenient to look at them side by side. And finally, as software developers, we love version control systems. We love to be able to iterate all versions and to see what's being done from one modification to the next. And software which are based only on binary files is not very convenient for us because we cannot observe anything on this. And finally, we used to always share all the hardware we make. And we realized that it's awesome to have open hardware. But if people need a multi-thousand-dollar software to be able to change one capacitor on your board, it's not that convenient anymore. And so, I think we use SolidWorks a lot as well. And most of the drawbacks mentioned earlier for Agile apply to SolidWorks. So, what we've been doing is that we've been kind of like listing what we needed. So mostly what I listed earlier, plus the fact that we need something which is either with a scriptable interface. Agile has a scriptable interface. It's Pascal, so it's not very convenient, but you can script things. But we wanted a software which has a user interface which is easy to pick up, because if you're changing all the tools you're using, we don't want to spend months learning a new tool, and having a way to either extend it or script it easily. And based on that, we looked at several open source projects for designing PCBs, and following Glue PCB for a long time and KiCad for a while. And last year, we actually realized that KiCad made tremendous progress. It's actually a piece of software which is like ready to use for like complex hardware. And it ticks almost all the boxes. It's open source, works on every platform. Every KiCad file is a text file, so all the diffs are readable and you can understand what's going on. It has a great community, so you have new features every day coming out. And it's been backed by CERN to design sensors for the Large Hadron Collider. And so they actually have a lot of features for very high-speed signals and then next tuning of differential pairs of this kind of thing, which are like, very convenient for us. Another thing we really appreciate is that every part of KiCad is a different executable. So you have your board editing executable, your schematic editing executable, and you can have them side by side easily and run as many of them as you want. And we also wanted to move to open source for all our mechanical design. And after looking a bit into the solutions, we chose FreeCAD, which is open source, had a Python scripting interface, and so we started to integrate that with our KiCad workflow. Every time we design a footprint, we actually have a script generating the 3D model in FreeCAD for this component. When we started to try to design robots with FreeCAD, maybe it's just because we're not used to the tool enough, or some of the features were not there, but it gets pretty challenging to design complex, like mechanical parts. So we fell back to Unshade, which has a drawback of not being open source, but has many advantages, one of them being it's a free software, the second one is designed by the team that designs 3D groups in the first place, so the interface is exactly the same, which makes it very convenient for us to actually use it. And it's cloud-based and made for open hardware, so it's very easy to share design and export them in any common CAD format. Of course, no open source software has like all the features you need, and so in the case of KiCad, we had to customize or extend it in various ways. A few examples of like features that we thought were useful for everybody was the ability to design footprints, not only with like our homemade Python script, but through the CAD UI, and that is something very close to what other CAD software provides you. And as I said earlier, every piece of CAD is a different executable and a different like, piece of code, and so sometimes you have like, inconsistencies, and it can be pretty frustrating when you use the same shortcut and it has a different action when you're editing a component or the library of the component. So we contributed a few of these features to actually just make it more homogeneous and easy to use for us and hopefully for everybody else. We contribute back a bunch of libraries that we created as well. But then there are a lot of things that we do that may not be what everybody wants to do with KiCad. So we actually designed a bunch of scripts that are like our homemade servers. So as I said, generating automatically both footprints and 3D models for this footprint to have 3D rendering. But also being able to just take pinout files from any vendor. We use FPGAs a lot, we love FPGAs, and having to type by hand every single pin when you design a component for a multi-hundred board VGA is not very convenient. So being able to take in pinout files and generating that saved us a lot of time. There is a lot of other like scripts that we designed. One of them we spent quite some time on is being able to generate bones the way we want. And so we extended most of the KiCad component libraries to take our custom fields and creating our own spreadsheet editor loading KiCad files, and being able to read our homemade component database and update your entire KiCad design easily. And this way we can actually export rooms and use them directly, giving them to our files. And most of our files today take KiCad files directly, so we don't even have to export gerbils and blue files, we just give our KiCad project. So a lesson learned or relearned from most of them, because we've been using open source for a long time, is that open source almost always makes your life much easier. To integrate that in your workflow, especially as a software developer, it's very convenient. And so, easy to integrate, runs on Linux, easy to extend because open source and the software is made in a modular way, scriptable, very, very convenient. One thing that was a very good surprise with KiCad was the fact that very often open source projects try to mimic the UI or the way of designing of proprietary software, but with less resources, and so it's always like a slightly worse experience. KiCad actually came up with a new way of designing, like of interacting with the CV design software. And that's a very convenient tool. You just have one hand on the keyboard at all times, you can access any feature with one or two keystrokes, and your other hand on the mouse. And actually, if I had to choose today, I would use KiCad because I design faster with it, and not only because it's open source. And finally, as for every open source project, if it's acting at interactive development, just update often. Every morning I download the new KiCad and I discover this very good feature that I was missing. And no contribution is too small to be useful. Very often we make tiny fixes and we're like, wow, like, nobody really cares about this one. And in the end, always contribute back what you have. Any fix is good today and it's going to help many people. So please, contribute back. So we don't do any hardware, we do provide some firmware sometimes, just for convenience. And there as well, we do rely on like many open source projects. I'm not going to go through the entire list, but one of the ones I want to point out is OpenMCD. It's so convenient to be able to debug any chip over JTAG using an open source suite. Don't need to buy expensive code, don't need to configure anything, configure drivers. You just plug in JTAG, load OpenMCD, and you can debug directly on your chip. Many Verilog simulators because we have FPGAs and it's convenient to simulate fast. OpenCM3, which is the kind of confusing name, but that's a project which tries to give you a unified API to actually program Cortex-M processors. And this way you don't have to rewrite your entire firmware just because you decided you can change the manufacturer and you have to like access a bunch of other registries. And so I advise you to like check it out. And all these projects are really awesome and yeah, check it out. So as much as we love open source, we do still have a lot of custom code. That happened fairly often that we decided to switch manufacturer and the project where we just updated the firmware accordingly starts not working as expected. And so, for example, we use USB a lot in most of our projects. And debugging someone else's USB stack is a thing. We spend a lot of time just trying to make something worth working for and like just investigating someone else's stack. So we do have like our trimmed down, not necessarily like fully featured USB stacks that we use on all our projects. And so we do still use quite some custom code. Finally, we do provide software as well. As I said, we use USB a lot. Most of our hardware, like most of our users, don't want to be hacking or flashing FPGAs. And so all our hardware is just like enumerating as a USB device, requesting firmware over USB. And through the USB, every time you start your driver, it's just flashing all the devices on the USB with the latest version of your firmware. So DBUSB is great, it's giving you all like full stack USB with like very, very powerful features from user learning without any effort. And so finally, when you want to put pieces of hardware together, especially robotics, that can be challenging. And so Morgan Pupi here came up with this crazy idea 10 years ago that if you could define a middleware and a set of interfaces to be able to communicate different processes, we could easily integrate components for robotics platform. And so he invented this name called ROS. And well, it worked out pretty well. It's today the most widely used middleware for robotics in the world, with millions and millions of users. And it just actually ticks all the boxes. Every robot can today like, just switch sensors or actuators without having to change anything. All the interfaces are the same. I'm going to go real quick through like, some of the projects we've been applying this workflow, this new workflow to. One of them is this camera that we've been designing for drones. So the challenge was that drones going fast today for drone racing, for example, have a lot of issues that cameras are like either too heavy, or LiDARs are too heavy, or way too slow. And so the goal here was to develop a multi-camera system able to give you hundreds of FPS per second, and in a very lightweight manner. And so this stack is actually two boards. So this first board, that's what I want to talk about, because that was my first complex board with Kaycan. So here we're talking like, I don't know, 3x4 centimeters, and a big FPGA, DDR3 memory, and our processor, USB 3 stack. So pretty complex board that was actually surprisingly easy to design. A lot of very high speed signals then, and with Kaycan I could just like, yeah, next tune everything and like match length and timing for all my high-speed signals. So very good example of like how to switch to Kaycan and actually have a successful complex project. And so then we have a sensor board on top, just like all the cameras and the complex AMR. And we also design robots, because open robotics. So what is that? Actually, I have it here. So we've been designing robots called TurtleBots for some time, which are fully open hardware robots. This one is the latest and greatest, maybe, which is all the hardware is fully open source. That means that you have all the cats that you get 3D prints or by putting part for it. It's fully modular, that's just one of the many variants. And you can then, on top of that, you can use ROS, put any sensor, any single computer, change actuators, and by just having the right ROS driver, you can just integrate it. So everything is available on GitHub and on Shape. Check it out, that's a great robot. And under it, we also like, always try to make it cheaper, so we have like, this TinyBot, which is our new project. It's actually not open source yet because we're still like, figuring out. But same thing, this is a full gadget design and an ARM64 on board and modular hardware you can plug in. Finally, we also used it for like stacking or high power design. So this robot was a massive robot supposed to be like, true efficient working. So most of the humanoid robots are using kilowatts of energy. This one was actually hundreds of watts. And so yeah, we've been using Kaycan for this, and so this project has been great, and we are looking forward to actually design other motor controllers, open hardware, so that anybody can use it. So yeah, that's it. I think my time is up. If you have any questions, save it for later. Good night.